Okay, everyone can see SAWM direction.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah. So SAWM direction, it's a forward angle of 15 to 20 degree 90 version and has an inferior inclination about 45 degrees. So our hip joint is a first class lever. So there is a rigid bar where there's a load arm and an effort arm. The load and the effort. The effort bar the abduction and the load is our body weight. So the first arm lever is seen like this, where the part A is an abduction arm and this is the body weight arm, where the body weight is a load and there is an abduction tension. The fulcrum formed by the center of the hip joint. And the load is the body weight and the effort is made by the abductor tension itself. To maintain a stable hip, to give a torque that is produced by the body weight to counter by the abductor muscle. So the abductor force into lever arm, which is the lever arm A, which is the abductor arm, is always should be equal to the body weight and the lever arm B, which is the body weight lever arm. So the biomechanics of the hip is based on joint reactive force. It is defined as the force generated within a joint in response to force acting on the joint. In the hip, it is a result of the need of balance, the movement arm of the body. The forces acting across the hip joint is the body weight, is the abductor force, and the joint reactive force itself. The joint reactive force is the summation of your body weight as well as the abductor force. So if the joint reactive force, what is joint reactive? If double the body weight occurs during a straight leg rise, while in a single leg stance, it becomes 3 times your body weight. While walking, it becomes 5 times, and while joint reactive force becomes 10 times while running. The aim of our biomechanics is to reduce the joint reactive force, to decrease the wear among the joint, in between the joints. So how can it be done? There can be strategies. Either we can reduce the body weight or its movement arm. We reduce the body weight itself or the movement arm, or help the abductor or its movement arm. Or you can increase the abductors to increase the joint arm. So the biomechanics depends on the stability and range of motion. It depends on the head size, head neck ratio, and the implant design itself. So if we increase the head size, so a better stability occurs. There's a less chance of dislocation. But if the head neck, if the head is small, it increases your range of motion, but on a limit of, it can dislocate easily. So basing on that, there is something called jumping distance or excursion, which is a distance indicates the distance of the head that needs to travel before dislocation occurs. The excursion distance is usually 1/2 of the diameter of the femoral head. That is the radius of the femoral head. Increasing the head size, increasing the jumping distance, obviously, and increasing the jumping distance will reduce the revision, because it will take more longer distance to cover to dislocate, and a larger head compared to a smaller head has a less prone of dislocation and a increase in the range of motion. But it comes on a cost of head neck ratio also. The primary arch also articulates before impinging and levering. So what is now head and neck ratio? The major determinant of primary arch of range of head neck is a head neck ratio. It is the femoral head diameter to the femoral neck diameter. A larger head neck ratio allows a greater range of motion before primary impingement occurs. So a ratio of less than 2.2:1 increases the risk of impingement, leading to fixation failure and limitation of function and dislocation. I hope everyone got it. If anyone has a query, we have our professor around here, Professor Pal sir, Datta sir is here all around here. If you have any queries, please do ask in the messages. We will really convey. We have our amongst us also Professor Tonmoy also amongst us. So so before going to that, let us study about offset. There is something called horizontal offset and there is something called vertical offset. So what is the medial or the horizontal offset? It is actually the center of the head to the axis of the stem. It is the horizontal axis, while a vertical offset is determined by the base of the length of the prosthetic neck and the gain by the neck. So this is your vertical offset and this is your neck length, and this becomes your horizontal offset. The depth of the implant is inserted into the femoral canal alters your vertical offset. So to increase and decrease the length of the implant or the limb itself, you can change your vertical offset. But biomechanics differs if you alter the horizontal offset. You will get a larger abduction arm if you increase the horizontal offset. So a medial offset is inadequate and shortens the movement arm and limp occurs. So, and there is increase in bone impingement. If you decrease the medial offset, which is the abductor arm, so there will be more of lurches and limp in a patient. If you increase the horizontal offset or the medial offset, the dislocation and increase in stress of the stem and cement occurs, and this leads to stress and loosening. So the effect of decrease in the neck length, the decrease in neck length brings a proximal femur closer to the pelvis. So there is a decrease in the abductor length. As the hip is ranged, the greater trochanter touches the pelvis, decreases the range of motion, and the hip levers and increases the chance of hip instability. So the adjustment of the neck length is important as it has an effect on both medial and the horizontal offset itself. Charley gave us a concept of low principle of decrease in joint reaction force. How did he do? He centralized the femoral head deeper into the acetabulum, decreasing the abductor length. So there will be a decrease in the body weight lever arm. If you put it inside, the body weight lever arm decreases, the joint reactive force decreases. The increase in the neck length and the lateral attachment of the trochanter increases your abductor arm. So this decreases your whole joint reactive forces. Okay. So before going to surgical approaches, we have Dr. Gunjan amongst us. Dr. Gunjan, can you listen to us? Dr. Gunjan?
I can hear you, but the screen is...
Yeah, we'll come. Dr. Gunjan will teach us or explain us some of how to do templating. Please, Gunjan, carry on.
Siddhartha, there's some problem with the live feed, like even in Facebook.
Yeah, can you get it?
Yeah. Should I carry on, sir?
Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Today we'll discuss about completing totally arthroplasty. Plating is something like which we do for a trailer of a movie. Before the actual operative procedure is started, we template the entire procedure in the pre-op period so that the outcome of the surgery is the best. Now, what is templating? It is the process of anticipating the size and position of implants prior to any surgery. The significance of this procedure is, as I have already told, it anticipates the potential difficulties and reproduces hip biomechanics, minimizes leg length inequality in any procedure of hip we do. Next slide. For any templating, the radiograph we need to do is anteroposterior view of the pelvis, which is centered over the pubic symphysis, anteroposterior view of the hip, which is having 10 to 15 degree of internal rotation. The magnification for any templating procedure should be around 20% of the standard magnification, even in digital or other methods. However, we do appreciate that the external rotation in such a radiograph is totally contraindicated. Why? Because it gives a falsely decreased offset. It creates valgus appearing femoral neck and falsely decreased femoral canal diameter. So at any cost, we are not going to external rotate the hip while taking this X-ray. Next.
So we need to do a magnification of 120% of the true size. How do we find it is a 120 degree magnified and an internal rotated of 10 to 15 degree? We actually do an internal rotation and measure the length of the LT. If the lesser trochanter, if it's not, if it is externally rotated of 15 degrees, it counts around 5 mm. And yes, if it counts about 2 to 2.3 mm on internally rotated of 10 to 15 degree, then this position only we take a magnification of 120 degree, because most of the templates which is magnified 20% of the standard or the true length. Okay.
Yes. Yes. Now in the our picture that is shown very beautifully, it has been marked. Now we see point number 6. It is the acetabular teardrop. Point number 5 is superolateral margin of the acetabulum. This is very important to get the offset of the acetabulum. Now one represents the canal of the femoral. However, it is used also for calculation of canal diameter according to dose classification in one what we represent. And Roman 1 is obturator foramen, 4 is LT, 2 is GT, and 3 represents the piriformis fossa. The center of rotation, what we want to explain by this is the ideal position for the acetabular template and component is achieved by placing the inferomedial edge adjacent to the lateral margin of the teardrop. This lateral margin of the teardrop is where we place to get the inferomedial edge. Next.
Okay. So before jumping into that, center of rotation should be known to everyone very clearly. What is center of rotation? The center rotation of the hip, that is the acetabulum, and the femoral head in a normal hip is at the same point. That is the center of rotation. So when there is a pathology, the center of rotation of either the femoral component or the acetabulum component or both the component changes. What is most stable in this radiograph is the teardrop point, which is marked as 6th, which remains always the stable point. This is the ilioischial line according to which we classify protrusio. There is one more point in acetabulum, the superior lateral edge of the acetabulum. Okay. Yes, so this point helps in calculating or measuring your templating part of the acetabulum. And for a femoral part, you should know the center of axis. Also, yes, this is a saddle. This is a saddle of the femur. This is a greater trochanter. 4 is your lesser trochanter and 1 is your shaft itself. So you should know part of the shaft itself. What we should know is the horizontal offset of the acetabulum. Either it can be calculated from a center line perpendicular from the center of the body, or if you draw two lines passing through the teardrop and make a perpendicular line from the center of the axis of the acetabulum, gives a horizontal offset of the acetabulum. It is most important or more important when there is a problem in protrusio or there is a defect in the acetabulum itself. Okay. So how can you make templating very easy? You should know what is the center of rotation. That's very good. You should now come back to acetabulum. Make a template of the acetabulum itself. Femoral part, you should know what is the femoral neck angle, what is the offset, and then jump to femoral shaft. So Gunjan, can you briefly tell about the center of rotation?
Yeah, the above chart is looking cumbersome, but if you imagine the acetabulum center, if you imagine the acetabulum center and something which is going superomedial, means a person is standing at any structure which is going superomedial to the direction of the person. That means the entire limb is going up. So this puts the picture that the limb gets shortened when the acetabulum center of rotation is superomedial to the femur. Conversely, just to imagine inferolateral, the thing of the acetabulum goes inferolateral. So the limb lengthens, right? So we can see the first square of the given chart that the leg is shortened with decreased offset where acetabulum COR is superomedial to the femoral CR. However, in the last chart, we see that the length is lengthened with increased offset where acetabular COR is increased, is lateral to the femoral COR. However, when both are equal, center of rotation of femur and acetabulum are equal, then we find that is the best thing where there is no change. So this is an easy way where we can understand where we get a limb lengthening and where we get a limb shortening. Another thing, now we find the acetabulum to be separated medially or laterally. If we go medial, it's very simple. If we go medial, we find that superomedial shifting is decrease in length. And superolateral shifting is increase in length. That by that way, we can easily get through the chart so that we can fill all the columns easily. And we can understand when we our output is when the length is increasing and when the length is decreasing after doing the structure. Now, this picture depicts very beautifully how the acetabulum templating is done. We make the angulation of 45 degree so that from the acetabular offset is made and it is placed over there. And various sizes are put so that we can understand which size is ideal for that particular patient. Now, the lower picture depicts about the door classification where there is three types. Type A having less than 0.5 canal to stem diameter. Type B 0.5 to 0.75. Type C is more than 0.75. The significance of this is if it is type A, then we have only requirement of a metaphyseal fitting stem. However, if it is type C or the diameter increases to a higher life, then we have to have a longer stem or a diaphyseal fit, a stronger fit, or we may have to add cement like that for a better press fit.
Okay, so to make everyone clear, this is how you do a templating of an acetabulum. So every time it should be known that teardrop is the most consistent part. So you put the template of the acetabulum at an angle of 45 degrees from the teardrop, 40 or 45 degrees from the teardrop. And also you can make an part of a superior lateral part which gives you a part. The clinical significance of this is the inferior tile is correlated to your teardrop. So you always start from the teardrop, and in clinically you start with your inferior tail and you make an angle, and accordingly you can size in it and find it preoperatively what size in interoperatively you will be requiring. That decrease your surgical time and lot of stuff. This is femoral templating. So after defining the center of rotation of the femur itself, you put an axis center of rotation and you fit according to the neck angle. If there is a coxa vara or a coxa valga. So if there is a coxa vara, there is always increase in the horizontal offset, which increases the stem tension on the stem, on the implant itself. So you do a lower cut of the neck in a coxa vara. So you have to place it accordingly to manage it. In case of a coxa valga, where the horizontal offset is less, okay, horizontal offset becomes very less because of the angulation. So you cut the neck at a higher angle to get the horizontal offset correct, fitting to the stem. Okay, I hope it's clear for everyone who is in the group.
Yes.
Yeah. So this is a task. Dipendu, can you come in and tell me what is this which you can see in this X-ray?
This is a protrusio acetabulum.
Yeah. So what do you see in this X-ray? What points do you mark to make a templating on this?
So first we mark the teardrop angle.
This is a teardrop. You have to make an ilioischial line. Is the amount of protrusio. And this is the teardrop. So after that?
Yeah. And then we mark the superolateral part.
Yeah, very good.
To get the acetabular templating.
Yeah. And how will you do a, how will you get a center of rotation accordingly? Of femoral part and the acetabulum part?
Perpendicular line.
See, you have to, I'm telling you again. You have to put a center of rotation of the acetabulum and femoral more laterally because it has gone more medially. You have to increase the abductor arm in order to increase the length of the leg. Okay. So you place your acetabulum from the inferior teardrop, make an angulation of 45 degree.
Right.
You know? it may overhang even the superolateral part. That is not an issue. The most important part is the teardrop. Okay?
Yes, sir.
This center of femoral head, you should know how much is the neck length left and how much is the head left. So you make a center of rotation of the head alone itself and put a stem. Now, if you deduct this stem plating and put it more towards laterally, the patient will gain a lateralization of the implant that will increase his limb length, will decrease his lurch, will increase his limb range of motion. Okay?
Yes.
Okay.
So, how are we calculating the center of rotation for the femur?
Femoral head, we are calculating it on a separate issue. This is the center, this is the head. Can you see this is the head?
Yeah.
This is a femoral. We are calculating femoral head center of rotation separately and acetabulum separately. And now you have to put this center of rotation to this center of rotation. So you are more lateralizing the whole thing. Your acetabulum is also lateralized and your stem also is lateralizing. Can you, Dipendu, yeah, you understand? Yeah,
yes, yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So this is all about templating. Now before templating, what implants to be used? We should learn more about what are the types of implant that we can learn. Okay. So before starting our basics of orthopedic, let us know about indications of orthopedic, of doing a THR. Kunjan, can you go ahead?
Yeah, definitely. There are many indications of THR. However, for our exam purpose, it has been simplified as the indications as inflammatory arthritis, femoroacetabular impingement syndrome, developmental hip dysplasia, some childhood disorder which in late age of life we do THR, like late calf Perthes disease, SCFE. Trauma obviously is a cause in which we do THR, and neoplasm, and finally osteonecrosis acts as a cause of total hip replacement.
Bearing surface.
Tribology is the science which deals with interactive surfaces in relative motion. It incorporates the concept of wear, friction, and lubrication. Bearing surface is the area of contact between two objects, primary bearing surface as well as secondary bearing surfaces. Bearing surface is what is perpendicular to the force transmitted, subject to relative motion. It's actually the relative motion of two surfaces in contact which is aided by a force, which is called as friction. This leads to wear. Now, how we define wear? Wear can be defined as the removal of material from opposing and moving surfaces under an applied load. The primary mechanism of wear are abrasion, adhesion, fatigue, leading to a third body wear. Effects of wear particle is mechanical, biological. Now, these biological can be due to direct cytotoxicity, immunological response, carcinogenicity, and systemic toxicity. Causes of wear may be due to motion between articulating surface, may also occur due to unintended impingement or motion. Wear leads to formation of wear particles. Now, how Sir John Chanley, a very famous orthopedician, have described low friction arthroplasty principle, where he has told to use a small head to reduce the amount of wear. So the friction can be reduced and the final implant longevity can be prolonged. He also advocated to use bone cement for fixation and stainless steel head on ultra high weight molecular weight polyethylene cup articulations. Now, bearing surfaces. For ease of purpose, in examination, we are asked about how many types. There is metal on metal, metal on polyethylene, ceramic on polyethylene, ceramic on ceramic.
Okay, as the bearing okay. Before going to the bearing surfaces, I would like to ask Datta sir. Alok sir, are you there with us? Hello. Yeah, Datta sir is with us. Yeah. Pal sir, can you listen to what? I think we are not getting an audio of Datta sir. Tanmay sir, are you there? Pal sir, can you listen to us?
we can just complete it and then we can.
Okay. We'll discuss after that. Okay.
Yeah.
Bearing surfaces.
Right. Bearing surface. Now, the thing is that to make it more simpler, those sir has told me the thing is that to easily remember these, because these terms as MCQ question we confuse oftenly. The first two words are the mnemonic for each of the topic.
Gunjan, can you make it very simple? It's metal on metal.
Metal on poly.
Ceramic on poly and ceramic on ceramic. Okay, we'll go to next slide.
Now, metal on metal. As we see the name MOM, so definitely by that MOM we can understand it is contraindicated in all patients who are intending to become MOMs. Right, very easy to remember. 5 to 10 times increases the serum metal ion level. So it is not advisable in all women of childbearing age. Long-term effect is a concern in patients of metal on metal. Carcinogenicity, metal sensitivity, and organ toxicity are important disadvantage of this implant. Local unusual lymphocyte aggregates called as ALVAL, acute lymphocytic vasculitic associated lesion, are commonly seen. Pseudotumors are also seen in metal on metal implants.
These are also known as pseudotumors, but it was only clinical significant till 1970s. After that, we have switched over to different, because there is risk of revision were so much higher that the metallic wear was around 13,500 times more than even the polythene wear. So it causes lot of metallosis in the and different biological abnormalities which occurred. So we restricted use till 1970s or 80s, and then came is polyethylene.
Viscoelastic and thermoelastic polymer. It's composed of long chain of monomer of ethylene. All carbon and carbon hydrogen bonds are single polyethylene. Types could be low density where the 0.910 to 0.94. High density where it could be up to 0.941, and ultra high molecular weight polyethylene where the molecular weight up to is 3 million nanogram per mole. Ultra high weight molecular weight polyethylene is composed of extremely long chains of ethylene, crystalline domains embedded with an anamorphous matrix. It has been a mainstay of joint replacement over the last 40 years.
Yeah. So the ultra high molecular weight has the highest density. After that, there are other also modification of ultra high molecular weight polyethylene. We'll come back to it later. Okay.
They have a very excellent result in elderly, which acts as the gold standard in elderly patient and geriatric age group. However, as the study by Skelm-Dreist says that 15-year survival rate is less than 60% when it is compared with people who are operated less than 55 years of age. Osteolysis is seen in 60% of young active patients with ultra high weight molecular weight at 5 years requires cup revision. The complications appearing is wear, osteoclysis, large head reduced dislocation and increased range of movement, but there is increased polywear. There is a catastrophic complication of liner failure with rim cracking with conventional polyethylene if thickness is less than 5 millimeter.
So the liner, if it is less than 5 mm, the polyethylene liner which is put on the acetabulum cup, if it is less, because you are increasing the head size, it becomes less. So what is the complication? There is increase in the wear. Also, there is always a liner failure. It will crack because it is very thin itself.
Yes. Now, causes of osteolysis, another important question. Cement was thought to be the cause of cement disease. Polyethylene wear particles are the cause of osteolysis, which causes reduction of wear strategies. There is improvement of design to lower contact stress and sliding the distance between moving parts. Altering the surface of polyethylene process of cross-linking. Avoid the use of combination polyethylene ceramic, which promotes osteoporosis.
Very good. So cross-linking polyethylene, because to decrease its wear rate, it is more resistant to wear, around 74%, as seen in one of the study in Journal of Arthroplasty, as well as in JBJS article.
Yes. Reduced cross-linked polyethylene wear lowers osteolysis.
Even osteolysis.
Yeah, incidence of osteolysis was 22% versus 0% for cross-linked poly. Survivorship at 10 years was 94% around.
94 to 100% in cross-linking as compared to high, ultra-high molecular weight. So a modification in polythene becomes to be a cross-linked.
Yes.
So again, next bearing surface comes to be ceramic on ceramic.
Yes.
So there was first generation, second generation, third generation, and fourth generation.
Fourth generation composed of alumina, zirconia, strontium oxide, matrix composite. 2000 onwards, it has been here started. Tribology of ceramic on ceramic surface. Most importantly, they have a smaller grains, which causes decrease in roughness. There is reduced friction. It is hard, so the wear rate is low. It is wettable, hence fluid film lubrication is there. This causes advantage of resistant to wear, and there is decreased osteolysis for ceramic on ceramic implants. Now, unique complication of ceramic on ceramic could be linear liner fracture. Why does it happen? Because it is a brittle material. It is not, there is less ductility and limited bending strength. There is squeaking. Squeaking happens in around range of 1 to 20%, which may be due to localized type wear, change of fluid film lubrication, and there is less chance of customization in ceramic on ceramic implants. Only one head size per cup diameter is available. Equalizing leg length and maximizing stability is more challenging in ceramic on ceramic implants. Other complications are liner chipping on insertion. Titanium cell is thinner than ceramic and has only 30% stiffness of ceramic. There is also difficulty during revision because we have to go for a procedure of total synovectomy. Liner exchange may not be sufficient as the removal damages the cell or even the taper at the time of revision surgery.
So what are the unique complication of ceramic on ceramic? It causes a liner fracture because ceramic is very brittle. It has makes a sound called squeaking, which is due to local strip wear. And there's a less chance of customization because there are not various sizes of head and cup. So limb length becomes a problem. It can cause a liner chipping on insertion because titanium shell is a thin and has only 30% stiffness of ceramic. And it causes a difficulty in revision because it causes total synovectomy is required to put a ceramic on ceramic. And there is also a liner exchange is
difficult.
May not be sufficient itself. Okay. So then implant more bearing surface came was ceramic on poly E, cross-linked poly or a poly E itself.
Yes. Both creep and wear rates of cross-linked polyethylene were significantly lower than those of ceramic on polyethylene. Varying femoral head materials, size, implantation period, and patient demographic, it had no adverse effect on cross-linked polyethylene, but on ceramic polyethylene wear rate and performance of high cross-linked and annealed ultra-high molecular weight polyethylene against ceramic heads.
Very good. So now, after cross-linked came to be a highly cross-linked polyethylene. Okay, so I hope everyone is getting who is participating here. If anyone has a query, please let us know. There is some question.
Siddhartha, one question.
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, actually the thing is that earlier, like you mentioned that the head size as it goes bigger, that is better because the more jumping distance, so less chance of dislocation.
Yeah.
But even the larger size gives you more wear rate. So, how do we balance the size then? Should we go for a higher size or, is there any guideline or is there any protocol for that or we measure that?
For a higher head rate, you need to decrease the wear. How did you decrease the wear? You made a cross-link and a highly cross-link polyethylene. So, now which highly cross-link polyethylene which is present has a lesser wear rate. Okay. So you can use an a head size more in a highly cross-linked polyethylene liner, or you can switch on to a ceramic on ceramic, which does not has a wear rate much. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. So so the thumb rule is if we go for a higher head size in any case, right?
Higher head size increase your stability.
Okay.
Always remember, but the problem is that it might decrease your range of motion because of impingement itself, but normally it's not an issue. The issue is stability of the hip and the range and the sufficient range of motion. So the abductor length or the abductor arm should be sufficient enough, or at the length at the level of the center of the head. It should not be over the center of the or center of rotation of the head. If it is over the center of rotation of the head, you won't get that abductor arm. You're getting me? So the GT should not be at a higher level. GT should be always at a tip of the GT, should be always from the center of the head or at a lower level to get that abductor mechanism to work. Okay.
Okay.
So we have a question from Vivek. Hi, sir. Can you briefly tell us me how to mark teardrop in a secondary osteoarthritis of a traumatic hip or a posterior acetabulum surgery when the local anatomy is distorted? It is very, very, very valid question. We also had a case, Vivek, on protrusio. I'd like to share it again. This is a protrusio where you cannot very well demarcate the acetabulum itself. The most consistent part in all the acetabulum deformity is your teardrop. It is always, in majority of case, constant. Vivek, if you can see this. So you have to put your template from the inferior part of the teardrop and make an angulation of 40 or 45 degree. And you can then mark the acetabulum and make an imaginary center of rotation. It is at this part which you have to put or lateralize the acetabulum. You get that? Even in dislocation of hip, you can always mark the teardrop easily. There is a, in this slide, I'll show you. This is a teardrop. Okay. This is the ilioischial line. If you trace the ilioischial line, you will find a teardrop at just above the foramen. This becomes a very consistent part. So if you can mark this point, you can actually do a templating easily. And clinically, if you correlate, the inferior tal is always stable, even in a fused hip. If you remove the piecemeal of the head, you can always find the inferior tal. There is pulvinar pad fat. Below that, will always there is a inferior tal which is consistent. So you can correlate clinically as well as by inferior tal, as well as by a teardrop by making a template. Okay.
Got it.
You got the problem. Okay. Now we'll switch to surgical approaches. We have a very talented young surgeon, Dr. Diptendu. Go on, Diptendu. Surgical approaches to hip joint.
Okay, so I have included all the surgical approaches to the hip, but usually we use the posterior and the anterolateral and the lateral approaches for the THR. So just to enumerate all the approaches, we start with the anterior approach. It's the iliofemoral approach of Smith-Peterson, which is the most commonly used. Other than that, we have a limited anterior mini incision approach and Somerville bikini technique. For the anterolateral approach, the most common is the Watson-Jones approach, which is usually done. Other than that, we have an anterolateral approach of Smith-Peterson and a modified Watson-Jones lateral approach. For the lateral approaches, we have the McFerrin and Osborne approach and a Hardinge approach, a transtrochanteric approach, McLaughlin approach, and a Harris approach. So moving on to the posterior approaches, as we all know, the most common is the Austin Moore or the Southern approach. We have the Osborne approach and the posterolateral approach of Gibson. So, some of the less commonly used approaches are the medial approaches like the Ludloff or the Ferguson's approach and the andromedial approach of Jatspin and the Kangabitoff. So moving on to the...
What commonly used approaches are a Smith-Peterson approach can be used. A bikini incision, a Somanwari bikini incision is always used in a pediatric population to reduce the hip joint. Okay. In a dislocated or dysplastic hip. And an anterior lateral approach is a modified Smith-Peterson approach or a Watson-Jones approach can be used. And in lateral, we usually use a Harding approach, that is a transtrochanteric approach. And posterior approach most commonly uses a Southern or a Moore's approach. Okay. So we'll only stick to the main approaches. What we have discussed now. Anterior Smith-Peterson approach. Yeah, go on.
So starting with the anterior approach of the hip, it is a split Peterson approach. So the position is supine with a bolster in the beneath the pelvis, and the incision, it starts with a, it's a curvilinear incision. It starts from the anterior half of the iliac crest to the anterior superior iliac spine. Then from there we go down distally for around towards the knee for around 8 to 10 centimeter along the anterior border of the tensor fascia lata. That's muscle sheath. Yeah. So that's the incision, and then so the only the anterior approach, it has two a true internervous plane. Other approaches, they don't really have an internervous plane. So for this, the true internervous plane at a superficial plane and a deep plane. In the superficial plane, it is between the sartorius and the tensor fascia lata. For sartorius, it is supplied by the femoral nerve, and a tensor fascia lata is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. Here we have to protect the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, which comes during the dissection. Then we go on to dissecting the deep fascia on the from the medial side of the tensor fascia lata. We detract the sartorius upwards and medially, and the tensor fascia lata from downwards and laterally. And then we get the deep plane, where we have the deep internervous plane, which is between the rectus femoris and the gluteus medius. The rectus femoris, which is supplied by the femoral nerve, and the gluteus medius, which is supplied by the superior gluteal nerve. So this is a true internervous plane. After that, we just we detach the rectus femoris from both its origin, the anterior inferior iliac spine and the superior lip of acetabulum. Here we have to look for the ascending branch of the lateral femoral synovial artery, which needs to be ligated. After that, we get the hip joint capsule, which is partly exposed, and we just retract the iliopsoas tendon a bit. And if you need some more exposure, we can detach the muscles of the ilium. We incise the hip joint in a classical longitudinal T-shaped incision, and we get the hip. So the advantages and the disadvantages, I'll just quickly read some of them. The advantages is that this is an excellent access to the, this gives an excellent access to the anterior hip joint. It has a good, serves as a good muscle function if we stay within the limitations and sound posture pre-care. Can be extended distally as well as laterally through the iliotibial band. It can even be extended proximally and medially. And plus, if we like, we were talking while the door classification, if we need a bone graft material, so this also gives a ready source for a bone graft material from the ilium. And there is also relaxation of the gluteal muscle, which is very helpful during the high riding cases. So, but the disadvantage is that we have to give a prolonged protection to avoid the detachment of the TFL or the gluteus medius. And there is a high incidence of heterotopy bone formation in such cases. And the exposure of the femoral medullary canal is also limited. Okay, so the anterolateral approach or the Watson-Jones approach. This is a supine or lateral. For hip arthroplasty, we prefer it to be lateral. If we decide to do it in supine position, we have to bring the patient at the edge of the bed so that the GT is overhanging. But we prefer to do it in a lateral way. So what we do is we flex the leg about 30 degree and adduct it, and then starting from 2 to 3 centimeter behind the anterior superior iliac spine, we draw 8 to 15 centimeter of a straight longitudinal incision, which has to be centered on the tip of the GT or the greater trochanter. The incision then crosses the posterior third of the trochanter before running down to the shaft of femur. So that's the incision. Now here there is no true internervous plane, since both the gluteus medius and the tensor fascia lata, they both have a common nerve supply, that is the superior gluteal nerve. So we just incise the fascia lata posterior to the tensor fascia lata. We retract the fascia lata and the tensor fascia lata muscle, which envelops anteriorly and revealing the gluteus medius and a series of vessels that comes between the tensor fascia lata and the gluteus medius. So after that, we retract the gluteus medius posteriorly and the tensor fascia lata anteriorly, and we get the fatty layer directly, which is above the joint capsule. And then we retract, then we bluntly dissect the fat pad from the anterior portion of the joint capsule. We expose it and the rectus femoris tendon. Now here we have to osteotomize the greater trochanter to get to the hip joint.
Yeah, before even exposing the capsule, you can actually do a greater trochanter osteotomy to get a better visualization of the capsule itself, and then you can do a capsulotomy after that. Next.
So we deflect the osteotomized portion of the trochanter superiorly with the attached gluteus medius to reveal the joint capsule. Now we incise the anterior joint capsule to reveal the femoral head and neck and the acerbicular rim. If we need a further proximal exposure, we can actually incise the fascia lateral proximally towards the iliac crest along the iliacus anteriorly. So to facilitate the dislocation of the hip, we can incise the tight fascia lateral and the fibers of gluteus medius, gluteus maximus. And now to expose the acetabulum, we just dislocate and we say resect the femoral head. Then placing just 3 or 4 human, we can just get to the lip of the acetabulum, which provides an excellent exposure. Now coming on to the lateral approach to the hip joint, that is the Bowers approach, which has been modified. I'll also show the modified approach as well. So here also we prefer to do it in a lateral position, and we make a longitudinal incision of 8 to 10 centimeter, which is centered over the tip of the greater trochanter in the line of the femoral shaft. So we divide the deep fascia in line of the skin incision like we did before, retracting the fascial edges to pull the tensor fascia lateral anteriorly. We split the fibers of the gluteus medius above the tip of the greater trochanter, and we extend this incision distally distally on the lateral aspect of the trochanter until 2 centimeters of the vascular vessels is also split. This is as similar to the protrusion. So we now we develop this anterior flap and divide the tendon of the gluteus minimus muscle to reveal the anterior aspect of the hip joint capsule. We enter the capsule using a longitudinal T-shaped incision. And then we osteotomize the femoral neck using the oscillating saw. We extract the femoral head and we insert appropriate extractor to reveal the acetabulum. So now this is the Hardin's modification of a direct lateral approach, where we use a trochanteric slide modification which was given by Dahl. So this is what we do is that instead of osteotomizing the greater trochanter, we just incise the tendon of gluteus medius obliquely across the greater trochanter, leaving the posterior half still attached to the trochanter. And we carry the incision proximally in line with the fibers of gluteus medius. So the advantage is that the greater trochanter and the bulk of gluteus medius is preserved, which gives an edge because of the rapid rehabilitation. But this is not useful in revision surgery, because we need a more extensile approach for revision. So there's an extensile modification where the gluteus medius and minimus are released from the anterior trochanter by performing an osteotomy. So moving on to the posterior approach, which is very commonly done, and it's the Moore's approach or the Southern approach. So what we do is we start 10 centimeter distal to the posterior superiliac spine, which is extended distally, laterally, and parallel to the fibers of the gluteus maximus to the posterior margin of the greater trochanter, then direct the incision 10 to 13 centimeter distally and parallel to the femoral shaft. That's the incision. Okay, next. So after that, we just retract the gluteus maximus. Then we get the fatty layer over the short external rotators of the hip. And we push the fat posterior medially. We expose the insertion of the short rotators. We have to, this, if you can see the picture, that there is no, the sciatic nerve is not visible. It actually lies in the substance of the fatty tissue. And hence, we have to be careful by placing the retractors. So we place the retractors within the substance of the gluteus maximus to preserve the nerve. So moving on. So now what we do is that in the A and B, as in the figure, you can see that we internally rotate the femur to bring the insertion of the short rotators of the hip as far lateral to the sciatic nerve as possible. Then we detach the short rotators muscle close to their femoral insertion and reflect them backwards, laying then over the sciatic nerve to protect it. So now we incise the posterior joint capsule to expose the femoral head and neck. To gain an additional exposure, we can even cut the quadratus femoris and the tendinous insertion of the gluteus maximus. So what are the advantages? It gives a relative stability of the operated hip. There's a very brief period of immobilization. Rapidity with which joints can be opened, like as we can see that with this approach, you can easily reach the joint with a relatively bloodless plane. and there is an excellent approach of the exposure to the posterior lip or the posterior column acid development. But the disadvantage is that because of the dependent incision, it has a tendency for edema. The acetabular exposure is inferior, and the there is increased risk of postoperative infection. Plus, there is weakening of the posterior capsule of the hip, which gives an increased chances of dislocation, which is the it's a primary disadvantage for such a exposure. There can be vascular damage, and there is also only a limited exposure of the sciatic nerve, which has a possibility of sciatic nerve injury. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for being a part of it. If anyone has a query, please, you can share it. We have Professor Pal sir here. Pal sir, can you hear us? Or Datta sir, are you there?
Yes, it is excellent deliberation. And this is just basic things. It is well covered. So in the next class, I think we'll discuss about the case. Suppose we will pit one case like that. And practically, we will discuss about how what is the what should be the head size like that, and anybody can make a video on that, and they will display that this is the weight, how the template is applied, and will interact with each other. Okay, do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
Is that these are basic? These are basic lectures are well covered. Next day, we'll give some specific case scenario. That this is the case, this is the preoperative problems are there, how will you prepare for the, how will you put the patient ready for operation. Everything that is for investigations, like counseling, and then the preparation of the implants, like templating, and which type of implants will be kept ready before operation. Everything we'll discuss for a case scenario. We'll make a case scenario. Absolutely. And we'll discuss accordingly.
Sir, there is a question from someone from Moscow. He's saying, can you please explain center of axis once more, how to plot?
So those who described that lecture, please answer him, and please send the question to him.
Yeah, sir, we'll put the templating part again here to describe the center one. Okay, yeah. Was in a biomechanical part, yeah.
Templating.
Yeah. He's saying about the axis. The question was on axis. how to mark the axis of lower limb. So there are two types of axis. One is the mechanical axis. The other one is a anatomical axis. Now, how to make an anatomical axis? Anatomical axis of the lower limb is made by the bisector line of the diaphysis of the bone. If this is a femur bone, you make two bisector points from the diaphysis of bone, two center points, and make an axis across it. So this becomes your anatomical axis of your femur. For a tibia, make two point in the diaphysis, center point in the diaphysis, and make a straight line according to it. This makes an anatomical axis of a tibia. So angle which sustained is your angle over the knee joint for that axis. What is a mechanical axis then? Mechanical axis is from the center of the joint. Your axis formed from the center of joint. So the center of the head and the center of the knee joint, if you make a line, it becomes your mechanical axis of the lower limb. So anatomical axis and mechanical axis makes an angle between them, it's around 6 degrees. This is very important in your TKR surgery, total knee surgeries. Okay. I hope, did you get the...
I can give a tips, practical tips. That is the yes, mechanical axis should be maintained during the operation. How do you check it during operation? So because everything will be under cover of the drip.
Cable test we can use the dithermic.
Yes, that cable. Is the cable test is one. Another is just before the dripping, we can mark the center of the head. When the patient is supine position, then we have to mark the center of the head, and we keep a small marker, a radiopaque marker in the form of a coin like that, and then we have to paste it on this. That can be a sterile coin also. It may be pre-sterilized coin, 5 rupee coin, that can be pasted on that just after dripping, and if the dripping is completed. And now after that, we'll take another, when we take the C-arm, then we'll understand that is the center of the head, okay, as there is a radiopaque. And yes, then we make the wire for the diathermy wire can be used with this.
Yes, okay. Absolutely. So there's one more question from Nikhil. He's asking how to mark the center of rotation of the femoral head.
So that is the templating.
Yeah, that's templating
the template.
This is the templating part. How do you mark the center of rotation of the femur? See, Nikhil, if you can see, there's a part of head, only a superior anterior part or the superior part or the lateral part is, or the medial part is affected. The remaining part of the head remains intact. So if you make, if you think this femoral head as a circle from the normal part, you can make a diameter from it and make two diameters on it, and the point which is dissects forms your center of rotation of the femoral head. Pal sir, you want to add something in that?
Okay, but okay, this is fine, but that is why I want to make a practical video. So do you understand? We make
we'll make a video for everyone
temporarily. Make and a case scenario before that. We will project the case first, and then we have once we have want to clarify it, we have to show the video that they are in this. This is the practical steps, step one, step two, like that. So that how will you place, where will you place, how will you mark it? Do you understand? There is one.
This one I tried, sir. We tried. We are in lockdown state, but I still tried to make it. If you can mark this head, this is the head part. This is the head part. And if you make us, if you see this, you have to take a center of the head. If you make this an axis and make a 2 point in this mark, either from here to here and a mark from here to here, you'll put a center of the femoral head. That makes it. I hope Nikhil, you got clear. We'll take our next class for a better. We'll put it in clinical scenario and put it in a better way. Gunjan has asked her a question. Any tips to protect sciatic nerve in posterior approach?
Okay, Gunjan.
Except for the retractor, he is telling that we are putting gluteus maximus. There is something like protect the piriformis. We don't touch the key muscle, like that something. Sir, 5 centimeter away from that, we have to dissect something like that, sir.
That is okay, but in a posterior approach, you can ask any of your assistant to keep the knee flex. That is one. Second. Yes. Once we take the rotators off, so yes, there is a special technique. Actually, I already shown to all of our colleagues,
yes sir,
and also my postgraduates. So how to take out the rotators, short rotators. Once you take the short rotators, there is a specific technique. So once the short rotator is taken off, at its nearest close to the bone up to the neck of the femur, and then it is gradually retracted. And that automatically that will protect the sciatic nerve. That is most. That is very very.
When you incise the external rotators, the external rotators falls back towards your fat pad. So it actually prevents your sciatic nerve itself.
Exactly.
Got it. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for being with us. It was very informative. Everyone, Dipthendu,
Definitely.
Thank you, Datta, sir. Thank you, Alok, sir, for being part. Thank you, Pal, sir. And thank you, Dipthendu and Gunjan. There is one more
question. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Okay.